Okay, hello, welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. This is episode 57 of Blown Speakers. It's a few days after Christmas, right? So we're still enjoying the holiday glow. I'm coming from Yokohama, Japan, and I'm joined by two Buffalonians celebrating that the Bills are now in first place, right? From what I understand. So welcoming back Greg Genco and David Gracon. Thanks for joining us, guys.
All right. Thanks for hosting.
Yeah. You guys buried in snow or what?
No, just a light covering.
Yeah, it's been raining a lot, which is weird. You know, normally in Buffalo you get snow, but probably climate change induced on some level. So not the same as when we grew up and there was tons of snow all the time and it was like over your head and you had to dig tunnels to walk through the sidewalks. Those times have changed.
But I do remember rainy Christmases at times as a kid, but not like this. Or yeah, I'm no denier. No denying.
Okay, so you guys chose this album today. I think an interesting selection. And why this album,
Dr. Gracon?
Yeah, well, I got into King Tubby actually when I was doing my dissertation research on record stores, and while doing this work, I got turned on to a lot of music that I didn't previously know about, you know, so I was really into punk and indie music and sort of underground stuff. And this guy, Greg, at the House of Records in Eugene, Oregon, you know, he kind of segued me into different styles of music, and dub and reggae was one of them. And so from there, I started buying some records and really started getting into it from there.
So Greg, that Greg you just mentioned, he's the guy that's heavily featured in your documentary, right?
Yeah, he's the guy with the lamb chops.
Sure. And okay.
Yeah, so I kind of wanted to go through a process of like what I call de-indification, which was like I wanted to get exposed to like other kinds of music and genres and styles, and kind of go more deeply into them as well. So it was really his influence, you know, which is kind of a byproduct of doing the research. He just kind of turned me on to some different style, yeah, different record styles, and King Tubby was one of the artists that he turned me on to.
How about you, Mr. Genco?
I think I came to King Tubby via Mojo magazine. I probably, you know, well, you know, like many other white music listeners growing up in the United States in the 70s, 80s, 90s, beyond. You know, I got into Bob Marley and the Wailers in high school. And then my 20s read a couple biographies on Bob Marley. And so I must have learned about King Tubby there. But the first time I remember seeing a picture of him and kind of thinking like, oh, I should get some records or buy a record was through Mojo magazine. And that great photo, which we'll show later in the PowerPoint, of him in front of the sound system or the boards, recording studio with the crown on his head, really made an impression. But as I mentioned to you guys earlier, it was also through Mojo, they were touting Augustus Pablo. You see here on my shiny CD. And he is the melodica player, musician. And this album, which we're discussing today, which Dave chose, when I purchased this recording, this CD in Japan, it's credited to Augustus Pablo. Oh, there he is. Mm. As King Tubby's meets Rockers Uptown. And yeah. So yeah, that's how I came into it. I like this picture, And I learned recently that the instrument he's playing, the melodica, was a instrument that they used in schools in Jamaica for kids to learn, you know, kind of like the recorder, a basic instrument that many kids in the US were given as a way to, you know, to learn music. And I guess that was the case with Augustus Pablo through, you know, to some basic rudimentary music instruction, but he obviously took it in a new direction and kind of established it as a, you know, a legitimate instrument. A more respected instrument, I guess.
Okay. Yeah. So there's like a few kind of confusing things. Yeah. That it's credited to, yeah, Augustus Pablo and King Tubby. Right. So
I think that's kind of great. Pretty egalitarian, I guess. Like, like, okay. You know, maybe I don't want to try a Jamaican accent here, but like King Tubby was just telling Augustus Pablo, yeah, you put it out, you know, I'll put it out. And, you know,
but I mean, but you I know, don't like but, King Tubby collaborated with a lot of people. So I think, you know, he collaborated with Lee Scratch Perry. This collaboration obviously was very important because he was doing a lot of the remix. He was doing the B-sides of a lot of the albums, which was basically, you know, an instrumental version so that DJs could play it and they could toast over it, which eventually became rapping, right? The idea of performing over a recording. And so my understanding is there's lots of different record labels put this album out. And so there's different iterations, there's different artwork, there's even different tracks depending on the label that put the album out. So I think that's why there's different versions. Like if you look on All Music Guide at the versions, there's like 20 different versions that were released. But I know, you know, King Tubby was really collaborating with a lot of different artists. You know, obviously the sort of key fundamental players of reggae he was collaborating with. But then, you know, the idea of creating the B-side, you know, the remix is credited from what some research I had done today to King Tubby, the whole idea of like the concept of a remix, the idea that became its own art form in itself, that it became, he brought it to another level of craftsmanship and sophistication, you know, really kind of remodifying tracks and songs. And then of course, adding all kinds of effects like reverb and delays and so really the technology was really central to bringing about this evolution in music, you know, this idea of these sort of remixing, but then using the studio as an instrument as opposed to like a performance. So the idea of remixing and like really kind of bringing an artistic vision to a song that already existed, but that in itself becoming an art form really in many ways goes back to King Tubby. So it's really fascinating how the influence of that then to other styles of music. Obviously he's considered a key foundation of hip hop, but also electronic music, ambient music, dubstep, which it's an interesting iteration. It's very different than this kind of dub, I would say. Then of course post-punk and punk. His influence is just so massive, and like I feel he doesn't have the same credit, or he doesn't get the same kind of recognition. You know, I think a lot, if you were to ask the average person who King Tubby is, they wouldn't know. But you know, if you ask people who Bob Marley is, they know. Everyone knows who Bob Marley is, right? But in some ways King Tubby is just as influential, if not more, in terms of impacting really a whole history of music. It's really fascinating. So I think it's really important to like focus on albums and artists that are underappreciated and like don't have the same, you know, obviously there's certain people who know about King Tubby, but, and of course in Jamaica, he was a seminal figure in the 70s. But I think in general, the mass consciousness probably doesn't know who King Tubby is, even though his fingerprints are kind of on popular everything of popular music, or connected to it. in ways. So I think that's really fascinating and interesting. I think that's why it's worth investigating this album and talking about it and celebrating it, because I think he's underappreciated.
What is dubstep?
Yeah, is, I mean, is it's that kind like of a more contemporary electronic music, you know, it doesn't...
British, right?
British, but also in the U.S. there was, is weirdly enough, when I lived in Champaign, Urbana, Illinois, there was, they had a couple key figures of the dubstep movement. It was very interesting. But, you know, you listen to it, it's much more digital, you know, it's kind of a little more aggressive, electronic. It's, you know, whereas dub is like, Jamaican dub is more like kind of minimal, you know, it's very analog, it's warm sounding.
Yeah.
Whereas dubstep is kind of like, could be kind of harsh and, you know, dubstep was very popular for several years. But I think dub is more sort of organic sounding and it's analog. So it sounds like much warmer. Obviously the technologies are very different. Whereas dubstep's very kind of digital sounding, kind of abrasive almost at times.
You wanted to say something about the album cover, right? Specifically the image behind. So this is a Pablo on the cover, right? That's not Tubby, right? I would say. Or is that King Tubby, the face on the cover?
That looks like Augustus Pablo.
Okay. And then so who's the guy in the background, Greg, you mentioned before?
That's Ali Selassie, who was emperor of Ethiopia in the 50s into the 60s. And yeah, he's revered as kind of Christ-like figure, a deity really, in Rastafarianism. An introduction for me was there's a Bob Marley documentary and Bob Marley's wife, Rita Marley's talking about when he came to Jamaica in the early 60s and she was raised Catholic, but you know, I guess being around musicians and early Rastafarians, you know, she knew that he was a high, you know, kind of regarded as a deity. And so, but she's like, well, anyway, she's like, I don't think he's really a god, but I'm going to look at him. And she said, as he was driving by in his car, when she was in the crowd and she waved to him, she claimed she saw the stigmata, the mark, you know, that Jesus apparently had from the cross. And so then she was convinced as well that he was, like a kind of second coming of Christ or a deity. But I think, you know, as Ethiopia is I think it was the only African country that wasn't colonized, that started his the esteem. I think that's where the esteem and respect begins for people of color around the world, especially, you know, as Jamaicans were enslaved people. He's big, like a deity in Rastafarianism.
Okay. You guys have any idea why it's King Tubby's, like S? Is there a story there? Or is it...
Yeah, I didn't read anything about that today, but, you know, we were talking earlier about the Rockers and who exactly are the Rockers, and there's different interpretations of what that can mean, and one of them is that that was the name of Augustus Pablo's sound system, which a sound system is like a DJ setup with very large loud speakers, and where the selector, as they call it in Jamaica, would play different music. So there's different meanings of the word Rockers. You know, I think we originally had thought of, like, you know, rock and roll guys. But it's actually a very specific term in the Jamaican context. Yeah, so focusing specifically on the drumming style. So maybe the rockers actually means he's meeting up with Augustus's sound system. Yeah, this idea in the UK that reggae fans were called rockers. But then also it could be a genre of reggae with characteristics of a beat drum focused sound influenced by rock, funk, and other American British styles. So it's kind of interesting to kind of figure out what that word actually means in a Jamaican context. It's probably different than like what a lot of like Western, when you hear the word rocker, you think of like, you know, a rock and roll dude.
Maybe some of our friends down at Yoyogi Park in Harajuku. But yeah, that's, well, we want to keep going with the
I was going to move forward to so we're going to focus on King Tubby today, but Augustus Pablo. This is what he did before this. So it looks like this was his third album. Yeah, but like you said, it seems like the record industry was rather chaotic in Jamaica. So who knows? But according to All Music, this is Augustus Pablo's third album. And here's King Tubby. Yeah, so some cool photos of him. So what's his backstory?
Yeah, so I did a little digging today, and so he actually started out as kind of an electrician. Like, he kind of was really into gadgets, and he repaired radios and TVs, and he then eventually got sound systems would the parties would get kind of violent sometimes, and sound systems would get smashed by like rival gangs or rival sound systems, or even by like the police, right? And so he would fix the sound systems. And so he was very technically savvy. He understood electronics, and he developed his own sound system over time. And then started working at a record label where he started then creating these remixes or creating the B-sides. And then, as I mentioned earlier, the B-sides eventually became an art form in itself. The idea of the dub, you know, not just some, you know, we think of a B-side as being something lesser. But the idea that in itself became, the studio became an instrument. The idea of manipulating the sounds, the layers, characterized by a lot of bass, is very prominent, kind of bringing these levels up. And then there's all kinds of sound effects, and reverb, for example, is really popular. The idea of like the sort of guitar reverberating. There's this idea of delays of the sound, and then the sound kind of dropping out, these kind of drops they're called, and kind of a irregular sort of sound, and then it kind of comes back, and then the drums are manipulated. I also read one definition of rockers is the manipulation of the drums creating a particular kind of rhythmic sound, and them calling that a rocker. So there's lots of different, kind of like the definition of ska is very sort of like, if you go to Jamaica and like ask the definition, I've seen this in documentaries where it's like different people trying to define ska, there's like 10 different reasons why that word came about. I think maybe rockers has a similar kind of slippery meaning, depending on who's sort of telling that story. But Tubby became then a legendary kind of producer, and he collaborated with, who's who of history of reggae music. Everyone from Lee Scratch Perry to Horace Andy, and of course, Augustus Pablo. So there's a lot of collaboration going on, and he was kind of world renowned even for his recording techniques and his ability to, use the studio creatively to, ultimately create an art form unto itself. The idea of dub is that it's itself an art form. It's not just the lesser B-side that he really you know, in collaboration with others, really helped to usher in a whole new genre of music, a subgenre of reggae. But what I think about, what I think is interesting about it is that it's pretty experimental sounding. You know, it's not, you know, Bob Marley to me is very kind of pop sounding. You know, he's very kind of mass appeal. You know, it's very kind of recorded a certain way, whereas dub is a little bit loose sounding. It almost sounds like there's almost like little mistakes in there. So it has a lot of elements, I think, of experimental music, where it's, you know, sometimes it's just instrumental. Again, all the effects kind of coming in out of nowhere sometimes, you know, has a very kind of more experimental feel. But yet it's still, I think, very accessible and, you know, pleasant music. Whereas some experimental music, you know, you'll listen to it once and it's like you're never going to put that on again. You know, I think we all have examples of that. But like something with King Tubby, it's like, yeah, it's experimental, but like it's beautiful and has a groove, you know. And it's, you know, my friend Greg in the House of Records in Eugene, you know, he's like, a little Tubby goes a long way. And, you know, I have, I think, four or five different LPs of Tubby, and he's right, it does go a long way. It's kind of like, what's the best song on this album? I mean, they're all good. Like, I think every Tubby record's good. Like, there's no record where I'm like, this one's bad. Like, they're all very interesting and unique. And, you know, one of the things I like about it is it's kind of minimal. It's a lot of repetition. No one seems to kind of overplay, like even the melodica, you know, it's pretty, in a sense, it's kind of maybe the connection to punk there. It's very kind of simple sounding, you know, the melodica is not doing any wild virtuoso kind of things. It's kind of just like four notes, you know, and a lot of repetition and a lot of, you know, so you can kind of see the parallels with punk in that way, and that it's kind of simple yet effective approach. I think is very interesting. I don't know if anyone else wants to kind of chime in.
I have some questions, but yeah, go ahead, Greg.
A lot of good points there, Dave. Yeah, I concur. It's certainly experimental, and you can see how his career as an electrician, what, you know, gave him his technical expertise to manipulate sounds and kind of be confident in experimenting. But yeah, ultimately, it's very listenable. And it's like a nice sonic journey as the things come in, drop out. And yeah, the drums sound amazing, you know, really, you know, with the reverb, and there's, you know, the drums are very clear, but, you know, have that reverb. And then, you know, sometimes that echo on the vocals too, it can be a really nice effect and give them some power.
It's kind of interesting. There was a time when the sound system parties became more popular than live music performances. So this is, I think, really interesting. And, you know, there would be these sort of clashes between sound systems, who had the best sound systems, and there was often like violence, but they were basically just huge parties and the music, you know, this big booming music. So you had to have the right technology to have the right sound. So Tubby was, because he was quite the technician, was able to create the best sound systems with like the most unique sounds, the most deep sort of bass. And then of course, him producing his own records, he would then have the newest material to play. You know, you want to have the most new cutting edge material when you're performing your sound system. But as I kind of read more about them, you know, it was really a kind of really vernacular localized culture. The idea of, you know, Jamaica's own culture was not on the corporate media in Jamaica. So the idea of having these parties on the street and like, it's a place where everyone could come together and dance and, you know, it's a big party, you know, that was really their way of distributing their own culture. And then, of course, sound system parties as immigrants came to New York and to the UK, Jamaican immigrants then, you know, these then, of course, spawned into other kinds of art forms and whatnot. But they were trying to preserve their own culture by having sound system parties wherever they were living abroad. And I just think it's really fascinating that it's kind of like a real, again, the parallels to punk, you know, this idea of like resisting corporate culture, this idea of making your own culture, putting out your own culture and preserving your own culture, something that's like outside of the dominant system, has a lot of parallels, I think, with like independent music more broadly. But of course, you know, it being a colonized country and the resistance and then decolonizing, the idea of creating your own identity, it has even a richer connotation, I think, in a lot of ways, of having authenticity, of having your own musical voice and something that's not imposed upon you by either corporations or by the state. So I think there's, you know, there's something really interesting about that, about those parties and the sound systems and then the sort of competing sound systems. And of course, Tubby's music was central to that, and him being able to construct and to make the music in the studio, but also create the sound systems. It's a pretty fascinating history that I think is pretty overlooked.
So I want to ask, since you said he worked with so many people, and you said his albums are all just consistently great. So then what is it about this album that makes it, so this album seems to be the most highly regarded. Is there a reason for that?
You know, I think for me, I guess I particularly don't have this bias. It was one of the first ones I started with, but like I said, I think they're all good. You know, if I listen to, I mean, it's hard to think of like, there's particular tracks that stick out. Like doesn't really work that way, at least with me personally. Like, it's not like, oh yeah, like,
sure.
This track, you know, in particular, like 555 Dub Street is my favorite dubs. You know, they're just like, whenever I put it on, like they just hit me and they're all effective. Like, I don't feel like necessarily there's a hierarchy of them being better. I mean, I think it's because this is a more overt collaboration with Augustus Pablo.
Okay.
Has a different cultural significance, perhaps. Mm-hmm. I mean, I did read online that people think this is like, if you're going to get into dub, like this is one of the records you should listen to. But I would argue all of his records are, the ones I have that I've heard are phenomenal.
Okay.
You know, mm-hmm. So I personally don't have a particular bias with that, but I think maybe it's the collaboration with Augustus Pablo, because they're both, you know, iconic figures in the history of dub and reggae music. So perhaps that collaboration, you know, kind of lifts both of them in an interesting way.
Okay. Yeah, because I just noticed it does get a bit more attention than other, right? Even if
you're
172 people.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just wondering if there was a particular, but and also I think it's interesting what you say about how these parties and people would want to destroy each other's equipment and stuff, but then the music itself is so calm. I think it's funny that to think about that, like rival gangs fighting over the equipment to play this very peaceful music is kind of interesting.
Yeah, I even read somewhere today that sometimes people would sabotage the gear of the other, you know, if they're competing to have the best sound system audience and fandom, you know. But also I read that, you know, police would break them up and sometimes it was violent, and you know, this was probably seen as a threat to power, having this kind of unity and you know, just like the punks were abused by police, you know. I think the comparisons are becoming richer and richer the more you kind of investigate the history of this subgenre. But yeah, that is right. And Jamaica itself is, you know, such like a chill country. And like, but yeah, of course it's very violent, has a very violent history too. So
wait, I think it's a good time to play a track.
Sure.
Yeah.
Just to give our viewers a taste. Okay, well, we'll check out a track just to give our viewers a taste. This is track 5 on side A of the album called 555 Dub Street. What do you think? I mean, pretty intricate sound. I mean, for 1976, for one thing, and just the equipment he was using. I mean, the sound is really amazing, I'd say.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, you know, the bass is driving it, and, you know, I can't imagine any hip hop track, you know, that's so bass centric, not influenced by this aesthetic, you know. I mean, the bass being so central in hip hop music, and driving, and the way it's utilized and its prominence in the mix. I mean, whole genres of music are, you know, especially hip hop, are just impacted by this. But, you know, I just really like the repetition. It's almost minimalist in a way, you know. It's you know, it's not a lot of intricate things going, you know, but there's just these little things here and there, but it still feels a little sparse, you know, like there's nothing crowding it. You know, I really like the drops, how the sounds drop out and then they kind of come back in this sometimes weird way that's like a little asynchronous or something, you know, like the music, it comes in this way that sometimes surprises you. Like it goes out and then it comes back in and kind of fades in this weird way that seems a little off kilter, which I think is really interesting. You know, it's like, I think this is like for people who don't like reggae, I think they could get into King Tubby, you know, because I think it is you know, I think reggae has all these connotations of like, you know, college dorm rooms and Bob Marley and just like smoking pot and, you know, this kind of cheesy, you know, but I think, you know, King Tubby was really kind of my foray into reggae. And then it helped me appreciate other forms of reggae and other, you know, whether it be ska to rocksteady to, you know, more mainstream people like Bob Marley. Like, I think it was kind of my gateway into, because I did have a background of like kind of punk and Indian experimental music. It helped me actually appreciate much more and eventually end up going to Jamaica to, because I was so interested in the culture and these histories. But just the use of reverb, the delays, the way the melodica doesn't really overbear, there's no overbearing kind of sounds. It's kind of, it is very kind of democratic sounding. And it just has such a groove to it. I mean, I don't know, there's just some, I mean, listening to it with headphones and especially listening to it on vinyl, I mean, it just sounds amazing. I don't know, it's just captivating to me. I can't quite explain it. It's just a really beautiful art form.
I think it's interesting that, like, as you mentioned, it's mostly instrumentals. I think there's a few vocals on this album at certain points, but they're kind of laid out like pop songs. So like they're all about 3 minutes long. Mm-hmm. And there's, I think, five tracks on both sides, one bonus track. But I mean, I just think it's interesting to take this kind of like chilled out kind of experimental music and you present it in like pop music slices, I think is kind of interesting.
Yeah, and I think the rationale for that, you know, because some of them do kind of like, it seems like it cuts out early, like this could go on much longer, you know, it's like, oh, that seems like a kind of abrupt ending. And I think that then goes back to the format, right? So I mean, these are B-sides on a 45, so they had to fit within that time structure to fit on a 45, really. So I think that's why some of them are so short. I mean, I think there's other tracks on other albums that are a little longer, but I think that's completely the reason. It was because of they had to fit on the format of the 45, right? So if that's the B-side out of the 45, you know, so I think that's why they're all kind of pop song length, because of the technical considerations. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. I wonder if they must have been probably later at some point, have they released like longer versions? I mean, eventually dub music, I mean, dubs were longer, right? When it'd be like a whole album track or, you know.
Yeah, I think on other albums there might be longer songs. That's actually something to be interesting to look into. But I think a lot of it does come down to the format.
Yeah. Yeah, that's...
I mean, for fear of asking a stupid question, if these tracks were on the B-side, then what was on the A-side of the singles?
Oh, so these, you know, so I think this is I think this is where dub kind of evolved into its own kind of art form. Mm-hmm. Whereas originally Tubby was doing the B-sides of kind of more popular artists.
Mm-hmm.
So he would take the songs and just, you know, take out the lyrics, you know, take out the vocals, and then people could toast over them, right? Okay. But then I think he kind of, as he got more sophisticated in his abilities, he then realized that in itself was an art form, that he kind of invented the idea of like really reconstructing the song so that it's very different than the original. Really could be accredited to Tubby and his ability to, you know, re-edit, you know, have the drops and then redo the drums and everything, you know, and add all these effects. Then like, you know, really using the studio as the instrument itself. So I think at first it started out as doing B-sides, you know, as kind of a job, right? And then I think it evolved into, with its technical savvy and then the evolution of technology, evolved into its own craft, which then he became kind of famous for.
Okay. Let's see. This is the back cover of the album. So when you say he became famous, how did that happen exactly? Like who started talking about him overseas, or how did his influence first travel? I guess.
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't completely know the answer to that, but I know that my sense is these collaborations with, you know, some of the key players. You know, Lee Scratch Perry and obviously Augustus Pablo. I think those collaborations, kind of like today, you know, it's like artists deliberately collaborate with each other to kind of share their audiences and grow in that sense. So I think his sense of collaboration was smart in that, you know, these other folks were developing a name for themselves, and then Tubby was affiliated as either an engineer or is creating dub music. You know, how that went global from there, you know, I imagine that has to do with immigration flows and maybe other, you know, I'm kind of just guessing at this point that then as these styles became more submerged in other styles, or maybe in some cases appropriated, or in some cases borrowed, he probably became more famous. I think he was a very famous figure in Jamaica in the 70s, but I think he probably didn't become famous internationally until later, I would imagine, when these records got distribution. Bob Marley touring the world most certainly probably had an impact on other artists and other subgenres within reggae. Most certainly Marley touring that around the world was, an advertisement to the other depths of Jamaican music. That's my sense. I'm not an expert on how that happened, but my sense is that Marley most certainly, you know, brought reggae to the world stage. There's no doubt about that. But at the same time, you know, Marley was kind of a pop, you know, he's kind of a pop musician in my mind. I mean, he's great. I much prefer King Tubby to Bob Marley, which is probably with like stoners, a controversial thing. I mean, I wonder if like real sort of stoner reggae people even know who King Tubby is, but, but I think like there's something like organic and really kind of raw about Tubby that I like, whereas Marley sounds pretty clean. You know, he's pretty, you know, even though some of his lyrics are very political and radical, you know, to me, it's very kind of overproduced, you know, at least his like later stuff, you know, and he got signed to Island and whatnot. So I would imagine that sort of globalization from Marley then perhaps led people to want to investigate more about reggae and Jamaican music. That's kind of my armchair analysis of how that may have happened. And then people wanted to investigate more and more.
Well, one interesting connection to Marley too is the personnel on this record.
Yeah.
David Hoenigman, if you can go back to the
sure.
So we have the Barrett brothers. Aston Barrett, I think his family man, Aston Barrett and Carlton Barrett both played with Bob Marley and the Wailers. Yeah, Aston family man Barrett played with Bob Marley and the Wailers and Lee's Perry's, the Upsetters. Robbie Shakespeare's on this record too, is from the duo Sly and Robbie. So it's interesting how they kind of, there was a smaller pool of musicians who share that were kind of shared by the different outfits. It says here, and just quoting Wikipedia, Barrett was the mentor. So Aston family man Barrett was the mentor and teacher of Robbie Shakespeare. The duo Sly and Robbie plays on this record too. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I mean, definitely, I don't know. I mean, well, I think Bob Marley was, I mean, he was a songwriter. And yeah, definitely a pop star. I mean, you talked earlier about ska being greatly influenced by American R&B. And, you know, I think, you know, like when Bob Marley, when they were just the Wailers, you know, he wanted to be like a, you know, like a, like Curtis Mayfield or something, like the Impressions, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. And, you know, and I think the suits, while they did, you know, the black and white suits that ska guys wore, Rude Boys were definitely influenced by the look of, you know, sharp soul singers from soul bands from the U.S. I think he, you know, and he was a singer himself, and then he became a songwriter, so really wanted, you know, the music to serve his sound, serve his songs. I don't know if there's, and you know, he had some, yeah, I mean, some of his songs are just very accessible, you know.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's interesting.
I don't know about overproduced so much, though. Because, I mean, this is certainly produced. King Tubby is certainly produced.
It is, you know? But it has a kind of, I don't want to say it's lo-fi, but it has a kind of, it has a really kind of organic. It's clean, but not too clean. Like, yeah. It sounds a little, there's a kind of like, it doesn't sound like very polished or like we're trying to get this on the radio. It sounds, yeah. Whereas like Marley most certainly is produced in that way. Whereas like how this stuff is mixed, you know, the vocals maybe are more lower in the mix and,
yeah,
you know, it's more about the bass. And I mean, yeah, it's a completely different
vocals, you know, at all. There's really, it's primarily instrumental music.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, I guess later, especially when Bob Marley was becoming a world superstar, you know, the first international superstar from Jamaica, you know, and on Island Records. So there's definitely some pressure there and some push to come up with hits and, you know.
Most certainly. Yeah.
Yeah.
Whereas Tubby, you know, he's, my understanding of these labels that put out this stuff, you know, they seem pretty independent. This Clock Tower was based in the Bronx. You know, so these are pretty small operations, I feel, that, you know, they're probably more like fans, you know, mm-hmm. of these records than like, we're going to make a lot of money selling King Tubby records. You know, they're probably more like a lot of independent labels, you know, they're kind of more into it for the art and the craft. And, you know, but I think it's just interesting if you, you know, as pop culture, reggae is a pop culture phenomena, you know, King Tubby is sort of buried in there, yeah, even though his influence is just massive, you know, whether it's electronic music, post-punk, hip hop, you know, he's kind of an asterisk in the history, but I think he deserves more. I mean, his fingerprint, I feel, is on a lot of pop culture. You know, if you turn on the radio now and hear some reverb and some kind of delay sounds, you know, it's like, it goes back to Tubby, right? I think that's why it's interesting to talk about him and to really kind of appreciate his records as being sort of a marginal figure. Mm-hmm. That didn't quite get his due. And it's like, the music's a little bit more weird, you know? I mean, it's definitely a little more out there. It's a little more left mm-hmm. field. And the fact that it is instrumental makes it inherently less marketable, I feel.
Yeah.
You know, the fact that, you know, it doesn't have words and some sort of centerpiece person to sell it kind of, again, reinforces its like sort of undergroundness. And mm-hmm. in a sense, it's kind of anti-pop culture because he's not this front figure in front that can be, you know, sold on a mass scale. He's like some weird guy at a studio who wears a king hat, you know. He's like, he's pretty like against the grain, you know, like he's not a very marketable, it's pretty underground stuff. I mean, I think people who are into Tubby are probably into a lot of like obscure music or underground music.
Yeah.
I would say.
But at the forefront too, well, we've mentioned hip hop and, you know, dance music, electronic music, kind of the first, or one of the first, I guess, DJs, you know, as the DJ, as a performer, as,
yeah,
and the driving force, the creative force of composition.
I mean, it's just fascinating. If a car were to drive by in front of your house right now with some bass kind of blaring, it's like, where did that come from? King Tubby.
Right, yeah.
That came from King Tubby. The idea that the bass should sound that way is pretty revolutionary to think of how that works on a kind of global phenomenal scale.
Right.
I think it's pretty interesting. So that's why I think, you know, he deserves some more credit. Yeah. And, you know, and I think his records are just consistently interesting and innovative. And, you know, they're just kind of, they're just like, I mean, they're chill, you know, like a little Tubby does go a long way. You don't need a lot of it. You could have, if you have two LPs, you're probably like, that's good. You know, but those, they hold up and they, I think they have, they retain a lot of this like creative value.
Yeah. And it's definitely unique. I mean, when you hear that, whenever, you know, it's like, whenever the first time you heard this music, either this album or this style of dub, it's like, doesn't sound like anything you've heard before, really, you know? Right.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, you could, if you'd heard Bob Marley, you can make a connection, but still, this is still unique. It's distinct.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you hear the reggae riffs, you know, but the way they're sort of remixed, mm-hmm. and, you know, it's very, I don't know. I think it's very interesting. Like the riff itself isn't necessarily the centerpiece either.
You know? Right.
It's kind of, like I said, it's kind of egalitarian, the sounds. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it is kind of anti-star, you know, it's kind of anti-spectacle in some ways because it's just the whole way it's done.
Yeah.
And I think that's interesting about it. And, you know, if you go to Jamaica, there's no, you barely see anything on King Tubby. You know, there's a Bob Marley museum that's very, you know, huge. It's like a huge, it's a huge tourist attraction. I mean, it's like a big deal to go there. And like I went and, you know, it's like this pretty elaborate building with all, you know, and I think maybe King Tubby is referenced somewhere in this history. But, you know, otherwise, you know, he's pretty underground. I remember asking people in Jamaica, like, King Tubby, like, do you like, and even Jamaicans didn't know who he was. Like, you know, so it was like, it's kind of interesting how, you know, how that played out. Or they were kind of surprised that a foreigner knew. Some people would be like, oh, like, I'm surprised you know this person or have heard of them. Because I think even in Jamaica, he's kind of amongst contemporary, you know, people may not know even that much, you know.
Right. Do we want to hear another track?
Sure. Just one thing I wanted to ask while we're on the topic of King Tubby being underground. I mean, was he able to make a living as a producer? Was he able to quit the day job? I mean, do you know?
Yeah, my sense is, you know, he started his own sound system.
Mm-hmm.
And then he, you know, started putting out records. And I think all these collaborations allowed him to kind of be a producer kind of full time. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting, as his career kind of went on, he eventually started mentoring other people. So he mentored scientists who went on, you know, his records are really good too. If you like King Tubby, you'll like Scientist. I mean, it's just like, you know, you can kind of see. So he kind of like was kind of training other people to sort of carry the torch, if you will. But it seemed like he, you know, I guess it's hard to, I don't think he was like living lavishly, but I think he was able to have his own studio and his own sound system. And then he was putting out his records. He was doing all these important collaborations. And then he eventually went on to sort of mentor other artists. So it's pretty interesting how, I don't think he was living large. I mean, Jamaica is a poor country, you know, but I think he was able to live off of his art, is my impression.
Okay, we're going to listen to another track, side B. This is the title track, right? King Tubby. Oh, but no S here. King Tubby meets Rockers Uptown. Yeah, cool stuff. Yeah, it sounded great on my speakers.
Yeah. That reminded. Go ahead here.
I love that echo on the vocals. And listening now, the rhythm is so prominent, and just listening to it now, the way the kind of skittering hi-hat made me think of another subgenre, the, you know, drum and bass.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know if I've ever heard trap music, but I think trap music is probably an offshoot of drum and bass. Jungle, I guess.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I think it certainly finds its roots here as well, all those subgenres, English dance music.
Yeah, that track in particular really made me think of the Clash's Sandinista. You know, there's definitely tracks, you know, where they use a melodica like that, the way the voice kind of cuts, you know, Joe Strummer, you know, you hear Saint it with like those same kind of, I mean, it's obvious they were listening to this record. I mean, it's very, very, very clear. But yeah, it's interesting too, like you're hearing sampling too. I mean, these are the earliest iterations of sampling where the vocals kind of come in and then they cut out and then the melodical comes in right after it. So, you know, that's a very radical musical technique. You know, the idea of sampling is so commonplace now, but that's obviously very new at the time to take something like that and remix it and cut it out and was really revolutionary, you know? So I think that's, you know, the idea of remixing and the author losing their power and they can be remixed in any way is a very radical moment in history.
Well, you mentioned the Clash, so how about we bring it back to the Roxy. Let's see if I can share. I can here. So let me get here. Is it this one? No. Here we go. Sorry. Dave, we spoke the other night, and guys, we spoke earlier before we started recording. When I first heard this title, King Tubbies meets Rockers Uptown, being a rock and roll fan, a rocker myself, I initially thought when he rockers as in people, but that was before I read that Wikipedia entry. You talked about rockers being, the type of instrumental, the kind of harder edged reggae instrumental they were creating. But anyways, I think it's kind of like foreshadowing, because here we have a picture of Don Letts, who was the son of Jamaican immigrants in London and also a member of Big Audio Dynamite, Mick Jones's band after the Clash. There he is there. He's widely regarded as the person who turned on the first wave of English punks onto Jamaican music, ska, rocksteady, dub music, when he would play the records at this London nightclub, the Roxy. And I think you can see King Tubby's influence here in their record Black Market Clash, which has a number of dubs on it. Armageddon Time, the Bank Robber dub. And the cover of it shows, here's Don Letts, here's his back at a riot in Notting Hill, and maybe about 1976, 1977. I think it also was the catalyst for the Clash song White Riot. But here's Don Letts, facing off or looking at the crowd of English policemen there. Dave, you just mentioned Sandinista, and I think a lot of rock fans and even, Clash fans who probably pride themselves as being very into the Clash and, very moved by Joe Strummer and his lyrics and the punk movement, but aren't aware of the deep influence of Jamaican music and dub on the Clash. Also another influence, person who a musician or musical icon who was influenced by King Tubby and his work, Cool Herc here, who also came with his family to a different place. His parents moved to, the Bronx. I was going to say Queens first, but they were definitely in the Bronx. So Cool Herc, but before leaving Jamaica, he went to, those sound system parties. And I read recently in this book on hip hop, Can't Stop. I can't think of the full title, but he talks about how he was really influenced and what a kind of revelatory experience it was for him to see the DJs come into these sound system parties. And then when he found himself in the Bronx as an adolescent, a teenager, he initially used his father's stereo system, but he was the DJ for I think it was a party, a summer party. His sister wanted to get some new clothes for the upcoming school year. And she decided she needed to have a party to earn some money, and he was the DJ. And then from that, he started putting on these block parties. And so really the original hip hop DJ. And you know, that toasting became rap, and became rap, you know, before Grandmaster Flash, before Africa Bambaataa, there's Kool Herc. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting to think of the circumstances as to why people immigrated. You know, I imagine folks were coming to New York to maybe escape the poverty or the violence of Jamaica. Whereas I know in after World War II, you know, places like London needed to be rebuilt, and they actually brought in a lot of sort of cheap labor, basically from the colonies, you know, to rebuild London. And I think it's really kind of, you know, it adds all these kind of layers of complexity of like, okay, well, then these cultures also came, you know, with them. And then it's kind of like how they intermingle within these dominant societies is interesting. And then sort of like how, you know, the musical styles intermingle, and there's borrowing, there perhaps even examples of appropriation, how that, you know, it's interesting. I don't have the record with me here, but back home in Washington, I have a Scottolites record, and, you know, on the back of it, there's kind of this manifesto of, you know, of course the Scottolites are an early ska band, you know, but they kind of, there's kind of a manifesto on the back that's saying, you know, a lot of our music was kind of taken by people, or we didn't get the original credit, or, you know, these, you know, whatever, it's like, whether it's the Police or the Clash, or, you know, they probably weren't referring to like Rancid at the time, but, you know, these
real big fish,
you know, kind of like white musicians, you know, capitalizing on this, like, you know, art form from a, you know, a colony, basically, well, what was a former colony, you know, not, and basically it's saying we didn't like get our due. So it's important to pay attention to the original voices and to like make space for them in the conversation, which is why I think it's so important to talk about Tubby and kind of like center him in the discussion, as opposed to like, he's a side figure of hip hop. He actually is like a seminal figure of making hip hop a thing, so it's like, and you know, and of course punk, you know, from time to time borrowed from hip hop, you know, the Clash example, you know, I would be willing to bet that unless people are really investigated and invested into music or really going into these histories, that they may not understand that connection back to, you know, but then there's these connections to colonization and globalization, and then like who's in the position of power to benefit from this and who's not, you know, it raises all these issues of imbalances of power and representation, which is why I think it's so important to talk about Tubby, but to like also center him as being like, his fingerprints kind of on everything in the pop music landscape, yet he doesn't quite get the due. But of course, I think there's very interesting uses of reggae and sort of dub techniques and all kinds of other musical forms. And like, I'm interested in how these forms influence each other and they get modified and redone. But I think there's still these like, unanswered questions of like power and like who has it and who doesn't, and you know, who's represented in the sort of mass culture, popular culture worlds because of these arrangements, is like between like the developed world and the developing world, is like, it's like a really fascinating discussion. And but that's why I also think partly why I wanted to like focus on Tubby and also like center him as not like some side note in these histories of punk and hip hop and even electronic music, but he's actually like a central figure to the existence of these genres. I think it's like important to frame it that way, I think. But I think, you know, the influence of dub music on, you know, post-rock, for example, is obviously very substantial. You know, the band Tortoise, their first two records, I think are completely influenced by dub, and you know, of course, we mentioned Sandinista, Big Audio Dynamite, you know, I'd say the Raincoats, most certainly Public Image Limited. You know, but then you have like MIA, you have, I think every hip hop artist ever in existence somehow goes back to Tubby. And then you have ambient music, even Brian Eno, you know, some of his stuff is reminiscent. And of course, all kinds of electronic music from Aphex Twin to, you know, to Gas, for example. You know, I think they're all kind of, you know, it kind of reminds me of Tony Conrad in a way, you know, and even like the Velvet Underground, like kind of like their influence on rock and roll and mass culture is so substantial, yet, you know, of course, they're much more recognized than King Tubby. But that fingerprint is kind of on so many things. You know, but I think it's interesting. But I think it's, again, going back to the point of like, we should center Tubby and not make him some like ancillary figure on the margins. He should really be like more of a canon, you know, and appreciated as like such an influence on a massive scale. So I think that that phrasing and like kind of wording, like how we articulate that is really important, especially when we're considering these histories of power and like who has it and who doesn't. And so I think that's really interesting to kind of think about those details.
The last track we listened to made me think of ESG. Remember, Greg, you first played me ESG.
Yeah, sure.
We did an earlier Blown Speakers episode about that kind of no wave lo-fi hip hop.
Yeah,
yeah,
and, yeah, oh, yeah.
Yeah, I could really hear an echo there.
They were girls, sisters. Well, what, two sisters and a cousin, or are they three sisters?
I think it's like four sisters. Something,
but from the Bronx.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know their lineage, but yeah.
Well, like something that's very minimal, but you feel you could like totally groove to it, right? So that's
it. Oh, yeah, yeah.
I get a similar feel, right? From
And definitely influencing or coming. Yeah, that was a distinctive sound, but something that was comfortable in different genres, because it was like that too. It was sampled a lot in early hip hop or throughout hip hop. But I think they released records on Tony Wilson's label, on the Factory label, you know, so influence on dance, you know, kind of post-punk.
When you guys
not well known.
When you mention Bank Robber by The Clash, who wrote that song? It's a cover, right? Who originally wrote that song? Do you know? Is that a
We can look it up
later.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that's maybe a Joe Strummer song, and then I don't know if they mixed it. I mean, then they're doing it in a dub style. I know that Armageddon Time is not. There is that, so I think Willie Williams. I don't know.
Okay. Wait, so Greg, who's this picture you wanted me to include?
Oh, I don't know. I thought this was a picture David Gracon found.
Oh, did
yeah. I just kind of wanted to display the sound systems. I don't actually know who's articulated there, but wanted to kind of give a visual of what the, you know, the sound systems of being these kind of portable.
Oh, okay.
Portable, and they would go to different locations and spaces and and do their thing. Yeah,
that thing's amazing. That's like a sound car, a sound system car.
Yeah,
like merchandise stand. That thing's awesome.
Dave, can we talk up to we talk about leading up to your Jamaica trip? Like, how did you decide to take that trip? And
yeah, I think part of the reason, you know, once I started investigating dub music more, I also got in very heavily into ska, especially early ska, you know, the first wave ska, things like Desmond Decker and Horace Andy, and, you know, started getting into the soul jazz compilations, got into some dance hall, some rock steady, you know, and even to some extent Bob Marley. So really kind of getting into Jamaican music. So I decided 1 year with my then girlfriend Frances, decided to take a trip to Jamaica. And I'm also a big fan of the Caribbean. So I just love sort of, I've never had like a bad experience in the Caribbean. Like it's always just like very relaxing. And but because of Jamaica's musical legacy, I most certainly, that was a reason of wanting to go there. So we went there in, it was a 2016. And, you know, a lot of Americans, when they go to Jamaica, and Canadians for that matter, or even people from the UK, you know, they tend to stay at resorts, you know, but essentially the resorts are these, you know, they're basically gated communities where you don't really experience the culture at all. I mean, you're basically in these gated spheres and everything's pretty controlled. And, you know, there's this perception that Jamaica is extremely dangerous. And, you know, it's almost like this perception that a lot of suburbanites in the United States have of the city, like the city's dangerous. You know, I often find these stereotypes questionable, but, you know, so I went to Jamaica. We ended up backpacking and went to, you know, basically around the country, started at Treasure Beach, it's called, and then went to Kingston. And, you know, I thought that, you know, one of the things I wanted to do was like try to kind of find some records. You know, I collect records, but not in like a profiting way. It's more like I collect records because I appreciate them, you know. But I realized very quickly, you know, even in Kingston, it was very hard to find records, actually. Like if you wanted vinyl, the records were extremely hard to come by. So basically, went on Orange Street, which is, you know, where a lot of these studios were at the time in Kingston. And so there was a International Rockers record store. Was like, a, you know, but apparently it burned down or there was something that happened. So there was just basically like a little cubby hole, kind of a disheveled little space with records. And they were kind of like a sound system were playing these records really loud, you know, very bassy. It was more kind of like dance hall records, like Sugar Mino and stuff. These are all people that Tubby had collaborated with. And yeah, so he was just playing, this guy was just playing these records. I ended up talking to him, and it was actually the son of Augustus Pablo, Addis, who himself is a dub musician who tours the world. And we've got a couple pictures kind of documenting the scene. Yeah, so I mean, this was the record store. I mean, this is like straight up out of, you know, an image you'd see on Soul Jazz Records on the back cover or something. You know, it's like definitely vernacular, you know, it's not corporate in any way. It's pretty disheveled. You know, it's not very organized. It's kind of like
the youth hostel, you know.
Yeah, or it's kind of like it has the aesthetic of like a flea market or something. You know, it's not, you know, you know, there was, you know, not a lot of records even to choose from. Yeah. So it was pretty cool. Yeah, like, 60. So kind of the old like sound system aesthetic, you know, he was just kind of, he had a turntable there. I'd be like, oh, can we just check out some of these records? And me and Francis were just kind of like, oh, wow, these are, you know, just playing. I'm like, this kind of, you know, booming speaker. Not many people around. And, you know, just like, oh, yeah, that record's great. I'll take that one. And, you know, just bought like maybe 4 records. So that was pretty cool. So to actually meet the son of Augustus Pablo totally randomly was interesting. And this mural was right across the street. Here's Addis here. So that was what was left. I know they were kind of reconstructing the record store. So maybe it has been built now. And so maybe now in Jamaica, you can go and get these records. So for me, I thought in my mind, like, oh, I'd be able to buy like lots of records and bring them back and enjoy them. But you know, there was pretty limited selection. And I think what's happened, because there's kind of a, you know, vinyl kind of gold rush, if you will, I think collectors, wealthy collectors from wealthy developed countries have gone to places like Jamaica, and basically they buy all the records and they take them back to their own countries and they sell them. I know dub and reggae as a genre is very popular in Japan. And I know Japan has very serious record collectors as well. So, and Japanese people in general have a lot of money. So you can begin to see how these records then, I kind of use the analogy of a gold rush, or it's kind of a, you know, maybe it's like a neo form of colonialism. You know, it's like taking these cultural goods and then selling them for more profit in the markets where you can earn more money. I've thought about writing some kind of academic article about this, but I sort of lost my interest in writing in academic articles. But I thought it'd be a really cool article to kind of explore these nuances of globalization and, you know, people from the United States or North America, the global North, you know, buying the records, taking them back and then selling them for significant profits, where in a place like Jamaica, you can't, you know, spending $30 to $50 on one record is probably not feasible for the average person. So it kind of raises these interesting dynamics. And I remember a couple of days later after being in Jamaica, I had an academic conference I went to in Seattle. And I went to a record store that was kind of near the concert venue, just kind of randomly stumbled upon it. And their reggae section, dub section, you know, reggae in general, was bigger than anything I saw in Jamaica, you know, so that really kind of made me think about these dynamics of power and culture and, you know, who has the ability to buy these things. And, you know, if Jamaica loses all of its records, you know, what is that? How does that impact Jamaica as a society? So I think they are, you know, I'd have to look into it to see if this store has been reconstructed at this point, you know, so they can actually have their own records to sell, you know. But I did go to, you know, this kind of warehouse somewhere in Kingston, just kind of by word of mouth. I was asking people, where can I buy some records, some used records? And, you know, it's kind of this disheveled space with kind of stuff everywhere. And, you know, there was records there, but they were like stacked on each other. There was no sleeves. I mean, they were scratched very badly. So I bought a couple records just to kind of bring a few, couple 45s I brought back with me. And it was interesting. The guy that was showing me the space was like, oh yeah, over, and this is a room just kind of full of junk and other stuff. And this guy showing me the space is like, yeah, over there in that corner is where Bob Marley recorded and Scratch Lee Perry recorded here. And, you know, so that was a pretty interesting experience, you know, this space where clearly history has happened, but it's sort of overlooked and in disarray. You know, that should be like a historical marker of some sort, you know, but it was just this kind of everyday space. And later in Kingston, a couple days, within the next couple of days, I ended up going to this kind of really kind of underground reggae party. And there was kind of dub music, there was huge sound systems. Yes. And I don't know who the artists were, but they were all phenomenal. And they were toasting over the records, kind of very old school. And, you know, it was outside and, you know, just copious amounts of marijuana. I mean, I saw on a table, you know, just a big pile of marijuana and someone cutting it with a machete and having these giant bowls, you know, like this big and these huge, and they were just kind of pass. I mean, it was an amazing experience. I mean, the music was just brilliant. There was this guy on the stage with a flag, just kind of waving it the whole time. And, you know, there's these tables of, you know, radical books, you know, kind of critical.
Was it a Bill's flag?
No, it was like, you know, some
member of Bill's flag. Mafia?
But it was just kind of cool, you know, like,
yeah,
this one guy's just, his whole job was just to wave a flag and, you know, and you know, they had these books of just kind of like radical, you know, Marcus Garvey and, you know, key figures of African consciousness and race politics and, you know, just books for sale, you know, it's kind of interesting to see this like pretty radical politic at this music. You know, you don't really see that at American music festivals where, you know, where they have tables of radical books. I mean, maybe at some obscure radical punk festivals, maybe you see that. But to me, that was very interesting that there was this like emphasis on knowing your history and knowing the history of politics and power. And Jamaicans were very overt about that. You know, like you'd meet random people on the street and they would just like fist bump you and be like, read more. That's all they'd say to you, you know, and just like they kind of, you know, it's just kind of this really interesting culture of knowing that history of colonization and exploitation and being very overt about it, you know. And then just the music and the vibe of that whole night was just like really magical. And there's like sound systems, you know, so I really kind of stumbled upon it very, very much by chance and by luck. because I think in Jamaica proper, like if you want to see and hear this music, it really only happens, you know, people like the Scottalites, you know, they might play, they make all their money playing these resorts, which actually doesn't actually, you know, accommodate the everyday person in Jamaica. Whereas this event was clearly like the people of Jamaica were there, you know, maybe they were kind of like hipsters a little bit, but it was definitely, you know, not a resort. And yeah, it was kind of like, it was a truly amazing experience. I mean, I was literally blown away. I was just like, wow, this is incredible. The music and the vibe and everything that's happening. And, you know, everyone's extremely friendly. And yeah, Jamaicans were extremely friendly and nice and kind. And, you know, they'll just come talk to you on the street and have a conversation. And so there's always this kind of like uplifting, like, you know, either it's like one love or read more, or, you know, you got to keep, getting smarter, you know, these kind of like phrases that people would just say. I was like, wow, that's really a profound thing to say to a stranger that, you know, you just met on the street. But so I had a really positive experience in Jamaica, and I think it was really important to kind of get off the beaten path, because I think a lot of, you know, people from the global north go and they don't actually experience Jamaica at all. They're experiencing this gated community that's like a simulation of what Jamaica is, and a kind of safe zone. And so I think it was important to, you know, kind of get off that path and experience some really rich culture. Yeah, it was real. That was a real treat.
One detail I want to ask you about from this photo. Just a moment. So this Rockers International. So that's basically the only indication that it's a record store there. It's just spray painted up. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's basically just this little kind of like a, almost like a storage shed garage, you know, that we would have in the United States. Wow. It was basically, just this little space. I think it was like a kind of temporary space as they reconfigured the old one. But, you know, it was interesting that records were so hard to find. You would think Jamaican culture has such a rich global influence, but I think a lot of the records, you know, are pressed by foreign labels, you know, and they're distributed through those channels. So it'd be interesting to think about like how, you know, profits and credits work to go back to pay these people and like how that works. And imagine it gets pretty complicated, but it taught me a lot about sort of cultural power and the importance of the local authentic Jamaican culture, and, you know, how they're trying to preserve that and hold on to it. And, you know, but it goes back to a lot of these, I guess, of economics and power. And, but, you know, I had a tremendously, I mean, Jamaica was one of the best experiences I've ever had, for sure, of global travel, in terms of, it's sort of being unique and, people being really friendly and, and the food and just the beaches and you have to really kind of find, you have to kind of really dig to find that authentic music, because those musicians make their money playing to tourists, you know, so it's pretty fascinating.
So sounds like an amazing trip. Wow.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah, it was great. Yeah, I did a little hike around the Blue Mountain, you know, the famous coffee. And I mean, the whole thing, it was only 1 week, but it was just, you know, the nature is very beautiful there too. And, you know, I stayed at this Treasure Beach place with like full on Rastafarians. You know, they had little kind of thatch huts you stayed in. And
you have this, this
view. Yeah, it was pretty amazing.
Good food. I have no idea what Jamaican food
is. Yeah. The food was really good. I actually caught a very huge fish, at that's in the Caribbean there. You know, fish that was literally like, I don't know how long, I mean, it was ginormous, but, ended up eating steaks from that fish for several nights. It was pretty, this place, would prepare for us, and then they took kind of the rest. So we gave them, kind of donated the rest of it to them. Wow. And but a lot of Rastafarians are vegetarian, so they don't eat fish. But there's actually a place in this little town called Smurfs, and you know, it's painted blue and it has like Smurfette on the other, and like they have the most amazing food. Yeah, and the coffee in Jamaica is just stellar. Yeah.
Is there a place called Steer Town? Or
I'm not sure. Like where is it? Is it in Kingston or is
no, it's more that's in from I think it's Steer Town and it's in my bookcase there behind you, but Keith Richards in his biography talks about going to Jamaica, and I think he had a home there, but when he first went there in like the early mid 70s, he hung out with, I think, Rastas in Steer Town. And he said he could only go there because he knew some Rastas, you know, some musicians. Yeah. And otherwise, right. It was like,
yeah, right.
It, you know, general outsiders and white tourists right. would not go there. And
right, right.
Yeah. So I'm wondering if that's.
Hmm. Maybe it's I'd have to look it up. Around. Maybe it's near Kingston or part of Kingston.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
But you mentioned the foreign labels, labels from other countries reissuing, and you know, we talked a bit. I'm wearing my soul jazz t-shirt showing Johnny Osborne. And, you know, I've great compilations from Soul Jazz, and you talked
about
and it just really well done.
Can you show that again, Greg, now that I have you big on the screen?
Yeah.
Johnny, I don't even know. I was trying to get a Jackie Mito t-shirt, and they were out of it, but I got the guy recommended this one, Truth and Soul, Johnny Osborne, Studio One up here. Not where, I don't believe King Tubby recorded there, but Sir Coxone Todd's label, where a number of, Jackie Mito and a number of other artists recorded. But they're just so well put together, painstakingly researched, seem to really pay tribute to the artists and the musical styles, the genres, Jamaica. I would hope that the artists get, you know, fairly financially compensated for the work. But
yeah, I mean, that's interesting.
Now I'm wondering as you.
That's like a whole other, that'd be an interesting dissertation or whatever, you know, to like, or
yeah.
I'm sure someone's investigated these things, but yeah, like how does that work and contracts and I mean, soul jazz is pretty niche. I mean, I doubt they're making tons of money. I mean, they themselves, you know, are, you know, pretty small scale. So yeah, I mean, I would hope that, you know, they're paying the artists or their families or whoever,
right. Probably,
you know, that, there's estates and how that works, and, you know, it can get really murky with how copyrights work in other countries, and like other countries don't have the same logic around copyright, and you know, or they don't think about it in those ways. Yeah, so there could be all kinds of complicated I mean, that and the records on the global scale would be really interesting research topics. Yeah.
Oh, well, one thing I wanted to mention before we continue, I was wrong about the Clash Bank Robber being a cover song. Yeah, that's a Strummer and Jones composition. I don't know why. I always thought that was a cover song, but yes. Okay, so yes. All right, closing thoughts, gentlemen.
Yeah. Whoa. We got a dog.
Yeah. maybe I'll pause Dave for now. Yeah, Greg, you want to go for it?
I'm very glad David Gracon initiated this Blown Speakers on King Tubby. It's been really informative for me. His place as the originator of dub and his significance in not only Jamaican music, but international music, you know. And yeah, it's been a lot of fun. And yeah, I like the one thing you said, Dave, about sampling kind of taking power away from the author, and how, like, you know, and but King Tubby kind of making you question who is a performer, or the role of a performer. You know, he obviously wasn't a traditional musician, someone who had a experience, career, you know, affinity for working with electronics, electrical engineering, and then with that expertise used in the new technology, used the studio, these technical, his expertise with this technical equipment to create a new style of music, and, you know, not by a traditional means. And just really cool music, experimental yet very accessible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, you know, it's important to note that he's one of the most important figures in the history of Jamaican popular music. I think a lot of folks don't know that, so I think it's important to shine a light on people who've been, haven't gotten quite the respect. I mean, I think in certain circles, he's most certainly respected, but I think sort of in a mass pop culture consciousness, King Tubby is most certainly on the margins, whereas I feel like he's really a center in terms of a cultural figure. I think he's, you know, not something that's like an asterisk in a history, but he's actually a center. He should be centered more in the history, and using this format to talk about that and champion his music, which is, you know, going back to the music, is amazing, beautiful music in its simplicity, but also there's all these complex things going on and layers and interesting use of effects. And, you know, listening to his music is also a history of music technology and how that music, how those technologies bring music in new directions. He's most certainly was groundbreaking, as we've talked about earlier, to electronic music, to ambient music, to post-punk, to most certainly hip hop. You know, mixing as a creative act, and this idea of you know, him being the inventor of the remix is pretty phenomenal to think about in the history of music. And yeah, just going back to this idea of centering these voices as opposed to seeing them as something on the periphery or something that's marginal, but actually bringing them to the center of their cultural significance is something worth doing.
I agree. All right. Well, thanks. Yeah. Thanks for joining me tonight, guys. And yeah, thanks. Thanks for watching or listening, our viewers out there. And okay, we're going to go out with a track. I forget the name of the track.
Sata Dub, Satta Dub.
Okay, Sata Dub. Okay, yeah. All right. Good night, everyone.
And let's not forget Augustus Pablo.
Augustus Pablo, yes.